diving into a world unknown. Space exploration efforts have taught us that the universe is massive and continues to grow and expand every day. As humans, we don't yet have the technology to explore it all. When looking up into the night sky, we see little stars shining back down on us. These stars can be shining from millions or even billions of miles away. But when looking up into the stars at night, have you ever thought about inequality in space? Now, I know what you might be thinking. Jennifer, how could there be inequality in space? And what could we even do about it? But there is an injustice in space, because some developing countries aren't able to have the same opportunities when putting satellites up into orbits. And this has been becoming a huge emerging problem. And we can start to do something about it by spreading the information in this talk. But first, I want to tell you about how I learned about this problem and became so passionate about it. Going into my senior year of high school, I had the amazing opportunity of internshipping with an aerospace company, Boeing. There, I worked under their propulsion department, learning about how we get satellites up into space. I was so fascinated about satellites in space and had so many questions. So I did what any other 17-year-old would do, and I went on the internet. I researched so much and found out about this problem that was happening right above us in space. My senior year of high school, we have to do a kind of research project about an injustice in the world. Since I went to an all-girls school, a lot of girls talk about women in the workforce and minority groups, but I wanted to talk about space. So I researched the problem that I had learned at my internship even more and realized that although space is unlimited, to us here on Earth, at least right now, it's fairly limited. We can only actually use what is in orbit. An orbit is a spot in space where Earth's gravity pulls on an object at just the right amount so that it can make an elliptical shape around the Earth. The three main orbits that we use for satellites are LEO, MEO, and GEO. Low Earth orbit and medium Earth orbit go around the Earth at different speeds. But I want to talk about GEO because it is one of the most important orbits. Because it doesn't just move around the Earth, but an object in the orbit will stay stationary above that specific spot on Earth. So as the Earth rotates, so does the satellite. This means that we can be collecting data from this satellite 24/7, which causes a lot of countries to want to put their satellites in orbital slots in GEO. But what exactly is an orbital slot? Well, to get a satellite into space, we need to have a certain spot, which we can call an orbital slot. This consists of a spot in space and a frequency that transmits signals back down to the Earth. Think of GEO as a public parking lot. They're not very well regulated, and in parking lots, anyone can really park there. But that can become a problem, because if people try to make spots that aren't really there, it can cause other cars to have to maneuver around it or maybe not even be able to get out. And in space, this is similar to how satellites can block each other's frequencies. Also in parking lots, we all well may know people who go over that white line just a little bit too much, or we might be those people ourselves. But that can cause a lot of problems too, because cars can crash. And in space, satellites that are placed too close to each other can cause collisions. And although you might have a really nice Mercedes or a red Ferrari, satellites in space can cost billions of dollars. And once they crash, that is technology that that country has to rebuild and remake. However, parking lots are organized to some extent. And in space, this is the equivalent to the ITU, or International Telecommunications Union. This is a union made up of countries, and what they do is distribute these slots. So, a country that wants to put their satellite in space would go up to the ITU and tell them where they want to put their satellite. And the ITU would make sure that no other satellites are close nearby and that they have their own frequencies, and they say, yes, you can put your satellite up into space. But this usually doesn't happen, because since there are so many satellites in space, usually the ITU has to say no. And then this country that wants to get their satellite in space has to wait until a slot becomes available. And as technology is increasing, more countries want to get their satellites in space. But when countries first started getting into the space race, it was mainly the more developed countries, such as China, Russia, and the United States. These countries had more money first, so they had more advanced technology and could develop their space programs faster. This means that they had most of the spots in GEO. And they did this also by using something called a paper satellite. Now, a paper satellite is a satellite that is only written down on paper and is never actually put up into space or even built sometimes. So countries would use these paper satellites to go to the ITU and get a slot in space and pretty much hold it for later when they actually did have a satellite that they wanted to put up. But this caused a lot of problems because going back to the parking analogy, we can think of this as traffic cones. And how some people put traffic cones in parking spots, we all know those people. And these traffic cones, they know that they're not going to use that spot right now, but they want to make sure that when the parking lot is full, they'll have a spot for their car. And in space, this is what paper satellites are doing. But I want you to all take a step back and think to some of your first days at college. This is a picture of my dorm and my floor. And although we're extremely close now, when we first met each other, we asked the same three questions that most college students ask, and you might have encountered yourself. And those are, what's your name, where are you from, and what's your major? So when I first met people, I'd go up to them and say, hi, my name is Jen, I'm from the Los Angeles area, and you know, I'm majoring in mechanical engineering and aerospace. And everyone would be like, wow, that's so cool, aerospace, how'd you get into that? And of course I'd tell them about orbital slots. But since they didn't know what orbital slots were, I'd have to explain it. But this was a great opportunity to let people know about this problem and realize what satellites in space even did. They might not have been as passionate about satellites in space as I am, but they realized that there was a problem that needed to be fixed. Now, developed countries have tried to fix this problem to some extent by renting out their orbital slots to other countries, but this is actually only hurting more than it's helping, because the key term here is renting and not owning. So these developing countries are getting rented slots, but after 15 years, which is about the lifetime cycle of the satellite, they no longer have a spot in space and either have to wait for a new one to become available or pay for another one. But the problem here is that these developing countries who are just trying to get into the space race have to pay for these slots when their original owners just had to go to the ITU and ask them if they can put their satellite in a certain spot. But I know what you're all thinking. Why is this girl up here talking about developing countries wanting to get satellites in space when developing countries have way bigger problems, such as people starving on the streets and no access to clean water? Now, I want you to all raise your hand if you were thinking this at any part in my speech. And it's okay, you can raise your hand. Well, that's a good amount of you. And all of you have a reasonable concern. But although some countries don't need to be thinking about satellites in space, what about the countries in the middle? The countries that are trying to develop their space programs, but can't, because they don't have the opportunity to even get a satellite into space. Now, a lot of people don't really think about this because they don't realize what we actually use satellites for. Because it's way more than just GPS, finding your house on Google Maps, or binge-watching shows on Netflix. We use satellites for military, land, air, and sea, being able to communicate back and forth. Environmental monitoring, to be able to know when volcanoes are about to erupt, or when storms and hurricanes are going to hit, so we can be prepared for these before they happen. But when natural disasters do happen, we can send out distress radio beacons to be able to find survivors faster. For countries such as India that are separated by rough terrain and diverse languages, these kinds of satellites are necessary for communication. These communication satellites help remote areas be able to get education and medical expertise that otherwise wouldn't be able to reach them. And that is why this is the next step that some countries need to be able to take. But there isn't that much space in these orbits, because right now there is roughly 1,751 satellites in space, and the United States holding most of them. And although this is helping us develop our own space program, it is not fair that we're not letting others be able to reach the same goals that we have already achieved. We need to realize that although this problem is happening more than 35,000 miles away, that it is affecting us right here on Earth. 35,000 miles away, just think about that, that's a lot. But it is affecting us right here, and that's what a lot of people aren't realizing. And this is why everyone needs to hear about this problem, because it's gonna take way more than just some aerospace engineers in a control room to be able to implement this solution and create a solution in the first place. That is why it is important that people from all disciplines learn about this problem and realize that it is happening. Now, when I first heard that I was going to be giving this talk, I told my friend David, and he said, oh, was that with Leo, Mio, and Geo? And right when he said those last three words, I realized something. I realized that everyone that I've talked to about orbital slots might not have remembered everything, but remembered something. And that's the start. The people that I have talked to have asked me questions about what this problem was. They had never even heard of orbital slots before, or even thought about satellites in space. They were other engineers, business majors, and musicians who wanted to help solve this problem. They would have suggestions that I had never even thought about, and we would talk about how those could or could not be implemented. TED is all about ideas worth spreading, and this definitely is one. Because you can't create a solution to a problem you don't know about. Thank you.